The first team one.
Yeah. Hi, we are team one. Vijay, Mayuri, Nikita, myself, Shubhi, and Gautam. So the idea that we were working on was how might we help a visually impaired person be more self-reliant, all right? And then we sort of track their day-to-day activities that they do, things that they might need help with. So cooking, shopping, traveling and commuting, basic activities. And then we narrowed down to shopping. How do we make the shopping experience better? So the problems were the lack of choice and confidence while choosing the products, lack of trust while handing over the money. So for example, if a blind person shops their own groceries, or at least to the local Kirana store or in a shopping mall when they go and they are handed a bill, they trust the person that they're accompanied with, or they trust the shopkeeper or the retailer to tell them the right amount, right? What if we could sort of reduce that dependency on the people that they're with, at least give them that information, that what money they're paying for what, and purchase information. And that too with validation and proof, you know? So even if there is an audio machine that we thought, like there are existing machines that say the amount that you have, but the blind person cannot go back to the shop, right? If there's a problem, there's no written statement that they have where it's not like tangible. An audio statement, they can hear it and it'll go, but there's nothing tangible in their hand so that they can, you know, look back at that purchase information also. So the problem statement that we redefined is that how might we reduce dependency of the visually impaired while they make transactions for purchased goods, specifically the transaction. The idea that we have is we're looking into printing Braille on bills and receipts. And we're already, so Mayuri and Vijaya had already had done a lot of ideation on this problem statement. And we're working on the product development right now. We're looking at all the options. Can it be a portable machine? Can it be a stamp? How can we do that thing? And ideation is on. The purpose, of course, who, what, where, why, and when. So it's for visually impaired people, people affected with blindness. So that there's ease in making transactions and proof of the transaction. It can be incorporated in shopping malls, grocery shops, any Kirana store or wherever a bill is being printed. And yeah, that's
our. All right. Thank you. So I've seen this problem and, you know, other solutions that people have tried on this, started to think about. Haven't seen anything yet completely done. Definitely, I think there is a problem. I have not interacted with anyone directly, but looking at many people have come up with this problem statement. I'm assuming that, you know, you also may have some first-hand experience. Have you interacted with anyone?
We developed a Braille stamp, but and I took interviews of blind and also the shopkeepers. So it was not very promising because they did not understand what I was trying to do, or probably I was not able to convey my idea because I directly went to the solution. I did not ask, you know, about their experience and everything. So we have a product, a Braille stamp, but then we diverted our topic to this because this has a concrete problem statement, which is crisp and to the point. So if you want, we can also share the product that we made. I mean, not a tangible product, but a 3D model.
Now, the next question for you is, who is your customer? Who are you going to sell to?
Yeah. The customers will be the shopkeeper, retailers, like the mall, in the malls. And the users like are different.
The beneficiaries are different.
But the customers are these retailers, shopkeepers.
Yes.
Who are giving the bills cash memo.
Yes. Strong reasons or motivations from them to do this? Have they realized this as a problem themselves? Or is there a particular set of shops?
When I was interviewing, once I put this out there, then they realized that, okay, this can be a problem. Oh, we did not think about this. So we can counter such a problem. So, yeah, they were hesitant, but then slowly when I was talking to them, they realized that, okay, no, this is a problem area. This can be worked on.
Also, to sort of think of the motivation behind brands or shopping malls incorporating this in their billing thing, I was thinking maybe, you know, they can, their motivation can be to advertise that they're being more inclusive. So I don't know. So right now there's a, it is what it is. People are capitalizing on inclusivity. People are capitalizing on and branding themselves and advertising inclusivity, right? So maybe with this product, they can advertise and brand themselves as an inclusive brand.
Perhaps you should maybe focus on that persona to start with. See, initially, to start your journey, you cannot convince everyone to buy your product, to educate them, to make them aware, to make them realize. There has to be something which will trigger it. You know, either they are themselves looking for a solution, right on the fence, right on the edge. Maybe they have publicly claimed that they are inclusive, that they want to do good, they want to do better. And then you jump in, you know, one way you can do that, achieve your goal is through this.
Yeah.
Right? Maybe it is the SDG goal or whatever. So you highlight that. But that is how you need to really pinpoint and sharpen the focus. Maybe I'll share a quick slide for everyone's benefit on how to look at the problem from the customer's viewpoint. And you know, there's a scale. Where is this persona? All right. So the problems, you know, in older days, we used to call, is it a nice to have or a must have? Is it a mosquito prick or is it a shark bite? You know, what kind of problem is it that I must need solution today? Like, I want a nice pair of shoes just because I want another pair of shoes, which is nice to have. Or I have a real pain in my teeth and I must get something to solve it. Otherwise, I can't function today, right? So where is my problem level, that severity, that impact that it creates? Now, there are two things that you should always be looking for. One is impact. Is it creating an impact in my life? And how frequently does it happen? So in your case, the frequency is every time anyone is shopping, right? I can create some benefit to the society. If I have myself claimed to my shareholders, to my, you know, stakeholders that I am progressive, that I am proactive in doing something better for the society and all those things, right? So those are the personas that you may want to look for any other, any problem. These are the ways which we can kind of divide them in, you know, at what level are they? So a latent problem is that they have the problem, but they don't know it. So, you know, many times, for example, if I ask, I don't know whether at home you guys are sitting on a chair or on a bed or on a stool, but how does it feel right now? Can you feel the whatever surface you are sitting on in any way? Like, is it hard? Is it soft? So before I asked you, you were probably absorbed in other thoughts and you didn't even pay attention to that, right? You may have had a discomfort while you started to sit, but you probably have forgotten about it and it's, you have taken it for granted. It's the way of life, right? It matters, but it doesn't matter that much, at least not for this job that you are currently doing. And you have become accustomed to it. So maybe they have a problem, but they don't know it. They don't care about it. Or maybe it's a passive problem. They know there is a problem, but it's not that big a problem. There are 1,000 other problems on my list in my life and urgent problems, bigger impact problems. And I want to solve them right away. Or it's an active problem, very urgent problem that I know it's a problem. I need to solve it. I must get a solution. I am searching for a solution, but I haven't done anything to solve the problem myself. If I find a solution, maybe I'll adopt. And then maybe sometimes you are in a vision category. The customer is in a vision category where they don't just feel the problem and the impact and they want to solve it, but they are so visionary that they have done some jugaad and have tried to solve it. And obviously, that jugaad is not their primary job. So if a solution comes along, they will likely adopt that solution and do their core job. So ideally, we want to start with the persona who is in the vision category, who has a burning desire and a need to solve that problem. It must be solved for them. If we can start there, you know, there is a whole, you know, distribution of people. Some will be early adopters and evangelists, right? These are the people who will fall in that category. Then there will be laggards, skeptics, and all those kinds of others who will follow them later on. But this is where we need to start. So if you are doing your customer discovery, if you are going out and talking to different personas, then try to figure out if there is a persona for whom this problem is really big and must be solved today. So I'll give you an example, quick one. So we had a team. They were trying to develop a method to track dance movements. So someone who would come in front of their app on the camera, and the app can tell whether they are making the right move. This elbow was higher or lower or whatever, right? So the natural target and their interviews were revolving around people who were trying to learn dance, right? Who were trying to better themselves, or they didn't have place to go to learn dance and all those kinds of things. Then suddenly they met a psychotherapist who was using dance in her therapy. And to do that, she had to do some jugaad, make some videos, upload, tell the clients and look at those videos and then give them feedback and all that. Now she was already doing this jugaad and she was like, oh, can you please give me this app as soon as possible? For her, this need was so important to be solved right away. I think that's the main input for you guys. Focus on the persona, really figure out their motivation, and out of different personas, try to zero in, hone in on the ones and validate your assumptions with them.
So we are a team of four people. We call our ideas based. It's a virtual reality experience. Virtual reality, everyone has been looking as a game or some interaction purpose to a virtual world. We identified that the main purpose of a virtual reality is to create a change in space. And that's where, we were thinking of this idea that there have been some times where there's a break time in corporate offices or in colleges, or there is an airport where's a waiting room or something, where a person is in a hurry and he wants to get to some place or he wants to go to some meeting. Before that, he takes like a 15 minutes or 20 minutes of break. So we want that time to be more efficient for a person, for which we were thinking what can be done or what is the use that could be done and how are they catering that problem. So like in corporates, there is a concrete building and there is a lack of space, which is evidently seen, especially in metropolitan areas. So they make some leisure spaces, like they hang some leisure furnitures in order to make at least some informal way of sitting for the employees, so that they get, they get a little bit relaxed within that space itself, and then later on be fresh for the next meeting. So that's how we defined our problem. And later on we thought of seeing virtual reality as a solution to it, because it is a quicker way to form the change in space which a person would need for at that particular time, instead of going somewhere else and walking somewhere else. So this is our proposition. Like, they have these nap pods within the campuses, and these are, many corporates are adapting to these. So we thought, can we make these napping pods better, or can we enhance them in a better way, so that even for a shorter period of time, the employee or the user should be much better, much relaxed, and can be much refreshed in a better way. So when I had one of these leisure spaces in my companies when I was working, and this was in a college also, which I visited during my architecture time. So it's like people are sitting there for, you know, half an hour, 1 hour, they're taking some nap and then they come back and work like that. So it is just trying to make this more efficient and much better. We haven't decided yet, like, what is the product approach, or is it like the exact product approach that we are going to do, or is it like the enhancement or attachment to the same products that we are going to do? Virtual reality could be a better way tool, because it's like on it could be on the way. It doesn't require much of a space. That's what the idea was, to use it. So the customers which we are looking at were companies which while planning, if they can put some napping pods in the companies, and a few colleges or universities also have these such kind of a spaces, like universities which are having incubation centers or co-working spaces, even they have such they could have such kind of products or service which we could cater to.
Okay, so first thing that I felt when you started was that your focus is on the tech. How it has evolved, but at least the way you have presented it showed very clearly that because we want to work on the tech, now we are finding a problem which we solve with this tech, right? Now, so your presentations should change eventually. But later on, as you mature, don't start your presentations. This is for everyone. That, okay, I'm a blockchain expert, so I'm going to talk about or have developed something in blockchain, and that's why I'm doing this. Doesn't matter. What the other person is interested in is, what problem are you trying to solve? Whether that problem is real and what evidence you have about that. Good thing about you is that you have experienced these sleeping pods. So sleeping pod was where, when you started to talk about the problem, that's where my thought was also going. And then you also, you know, went there and you have experienced it. Now the question to you would be, what was the problem in sleeping pods?
Time. So there are times when these are the number of them, how much do we have? Because it's like, if there are 80 people, usually company have just one or two, and people are sleeping over there because they want, like, the napping time is much more, I would say. That was one of the problems which, you know, line lag jati hai ki yaar, iske baad jaunga main. I have a meeting to catch up, please. I need at least 2 minutes of rest.
How long were people napping for it?
We're just saying that it could have been, your product was an alternative to the pod, which doesn't occupy space, is just a head camera, and you put it on and you're napping.
I did not realize that.
I'm just suggesting, but Anshul, if that was a problem, I'm suggesting that, but something else actually. Anshul, are you saying then?
I'm saying the same thing, just that sir said ki what was the problem when I was experiencing. So this is what I'm telling ki, it's the number of people who wants to use are more than the number of pods. That's the first. And secondly, if you are there for 15, 20 minutes, you don't actually, aap refresh nahi hote itne easily. It's not sufficient for a person. It's not enough for you like that.
I think in your case, that space problem and the number of units versus people, that you need to work around. Customers definitely are going to be companies. So someone in the company who cares about, so maybe the HR is someone you need to understand what kind of initiatives they are taking. If they have done sleeping pods, why? If they have not done sleeping pods, why not? Maybe that's where you can start, that maybe it was too expensive and, you know, it takes too much space and they can't have enough. But if your unit is more efficient and more cost effective, maybe they can have multiple or whatever. And then I think the science will matter. So if you can actually club up with something, you know, someone, and actually prove it scientifically that yes, this actually leads to refreshment, and have measure.
About that, actually the same. So we tried this experiment with it's a device called Empatica E4, which maps the skin sensitivity from neurons.
Very good.
So we'll go to next team.
Let's just start with what what exactly we want to sell. We want to sell sensory experiences, and people sell sensory experiences every day. You go to a restaurant, you're eating food, that is an experience. You go to the theater, you watch a film, there's AC, that is also a sensory experience. And what we wanted to do is use sensory experiences to assist the development of mindfulness-based stress reduction. Stress is at an all-time high given to Corona. We're just one step away from a mass hysteria. And we really want to have people more grounded in their reality and not think about the past and the past and the future so much. To do this, the best way we thought to go forward is to increase sensitivity to these sensory perceptions. We look at things, we see, we feel things, we taste things. And how can this be sold and made into the market? So one way to kind of narrow down is that we chose it to be for adults aged from 20 to even the elder population, but like around 40s to 50s. And we wanted to also focus on being able to meditate and be mindful in crowded environments. Because meditation and things are always seen as a thing that you do in isolation when you have a peace of mind. Mm-hmm. But often anxiety doesn't come at, ke, achha, theek hai, abhi raat ko sone ja rahe hai. So let us make it a point to trouble this girl. So that's what the two focus areas for us have been.
So there are different kind of meditation. So one which I have focused on is focused meditation, in which, I mean, this thread spinner I have made, taken inspiration from Tibetan prayer wheel. So basically the people, they chant prayers, I mean, rotating the wheel. Similarly, it, I mean, it produces a sound which helps the person to focus on something and, I mean, to bring their focus in a single, path. So similarly, I have, sketched a product which can be a thread spinner, and inside that there can be a ball bearing and also the ball. So when the when you rotate, this thread spinner, it can create a sound, and similarly, we can focus our attention towards that sound. So this is one of the idea, and the next one is.
It is a very nostalgia driven concept. It is a peach pencil. It is just a simple wax pencil, and when we were young, we used to like fancy when you sharpen a pencil, you get that sharpened flower out. So we came up with a lot of ideas. This is just one of them. This is a gradient tile board. So it is a simple board frame with small tiles of gradient, and you can arrange it from one color to another. It is just going to help you like a fun activity, a fun and where you can like focus and match each color, and it's a little board game kind of concept. So it's a Zen garden. It is inspired from Japanese Zen garden, in which they rotate a ball, a metal ball on a dish of sand. So I try to go with the same kind of concept where they have a lot of embossed stuff too, just to rotate in a dish, and the sound and the senses where the things move around the board gives you some kind of satisfaction. And this is a ball puzzle. This is a, like infinite ball puzzle kind of concept where they have puzzles on both sides of the board. And once you get the ball from one hole to other hole, you can just rotate the board and you can play this thing, the whole thing again. All of my concepts were more nostalgia driven.
Yeah, so one idea I thought was just like something to focus your attention to, something like balance beads. It's very rudimentary an idea, but there'll be two beads that you can hold in your hand, and there is another bead in the center. And the task is to place that bead at different markings across the thread. This I thought would, like, it's based on the assumption that it would be very challenging as you increase the length of the thread and things. So that would divert your attention from thinking about going on different tangents and just focusing on this thing. The next idea is something of a textured disc. First, we thought that it can be a textured book, but you know, we have been not interacting with the natural world for a while now, and I thought, ki, what if there is a disc, there are tiny protrusions on it that can imitate different textures from the natural world, and then you can just focus. That is something that would be an assistance to focusing your attention.
Yeah, so this is more to do with light and sound. So a device that, you know, points a small light somewhere in the room. And then the light, you just have to look at the light wherever it is falling on the walls, and it will guide you through the room. So that would be like one point that you get to focus on and meanwhile not think about anything else. And so this could be done in a dark room before sleeping, or, you know, it could even have like a sound aspect to it where, you know, it is this whole guided experience of light and sound.
So my question here would be, are you planning to sell each of these or, you know, one of these easily, or are you thinking about, I'm still not clear on whether it will be like an experience, meaning it will be like a retreat or somewhere, you know, people sign up for 2-3 days and then you will make them go through various activities. What kind of model are you thinking about?
That is a very interesting idea. But we were thinking of having one of the products. The thing is, we ideated a lot, but now we don't know like which would be the most successful one. So that is the dilemma.
I just wanted to add that since some of them are very small products engaging different senses, so it could be like a customizable kit which people could choose. So that was one thing we were thinking of.
Or maybe there could be a start product and other can be the coordinates. So we were mainly, because we are focusing on, this meditation, mode of meditation. So one thing can be a major product and other can be the coordinates with it.
And who is your target persona? Because this definition is very broad. You know, adults is very broad. I mean, there are people who are actively looking to do meditation, to do mindfulness related things, you know, there, or relieving their stress and all that. When and whom would you want to target? Someone who is already into all this, someone who is very new, someone what kind of trigger event may make someone to do, you know, a search or look out for these solutions?
Mm-hmm. I think we are majorly looking in the sector for corporate people because they have a very caught up routine. And I think if you are, selecting the section of corporates, we can also get hold on people aging from 20 to 50 years or 60 years. So that is a wide section of people we can target. So
it's very wide.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you targeting individuals or corporates?
I think we are targeting corporates as a whole.
Okay, so then you need to go and talk to whom?
The HR representatives.
No, even the people directly, beneficiaries, no? And for selling, of course, the HR, but beneficiaries would be the key, no? Like people who, will this concept work? Because the customers have to say that it's good for them, and then the HR will say, okay, this is a good idea.
Who can influence a parent to buy a baby cream? A pediatrician could be a recommender.
Yeah.
Comes with an authority and prescription, recommends that, okay, go ahead and buy this one. Then some is a buyer. Who is holding the budget in corporate? Maybe the CFO is holding the budget.
Right.
Oh, whether we can actually purchase or do this thing in financial year.
The topic is really exciting, but you know, like the solutions are not matching. Of course, the solutions also are very nice, but they have a lot of developmental angle in them, right? The light one, the end, which is multiple lights flowing. I may have some pointers with me, laser pointers, and I'm moving, and I can have this IoT devices, which sounds are coming, just to engage me, right? To take me out of that thought process. But even support for meditation, you know, like initially I thought you'll just go to develop some wonderful, you know, just a count or a small music rhythm to get into a meditation mode. You know, even that is possible.
Right. That's a wonderful advice. And we've taken... these ideas into consideration, so we will be integrating them.
Okay. We'll go to the next team, team 4.
So basically, this is our problem statement, that developmental problems are ongoing, persistent, and do not go away on their own. So due to parents' hectic working schedules, they cannot focus on their infants or toddler to develop their hand-eye coordination, or is obsessed with repetitive actions, or has excessive aggressive behaviors. So how can we teach these kids about motor skills, thinking process, shape and color understanding, and enhance their concentration power in a very playful manner? So this is what we come up as a design problem or design challenge, like developing motor skill for younger age group, let's say 6 to 12 years, focusing on eye-hand coordination and enhance their concentration power in a playful manner. So we are just reaching out to our potential customers and researching at the same time to understand better their needs and pain points. We want to be just customer-oriented. We want to know if they are looking for a product, service, so that we are know what they want, what should we keep in our product and what should we not. We are also reaching out to various families and parents who have a hectic working schedule. So for this, our target customer is working parents, to convince them to buy a product for their kids. So to help them with a product or game, basically, which can even help them with developing their skill sets. Other than parents, we would also like to look at the daycare firms who take care of children and keep them engaged while their parents are working. So this is what our target customer looks like. So we are at the same time researching more about what idea should be looked at this point.
So if the target customer is parents, how do they solve the problem today? What do they try to do to solve? When do they realize that this is something that needs to be solved? What kind of things are they trying? What kind of bouquet of offerings they have at their disposal? Where do they get frustrated if they don't have those options?
At the moment, we are still trying to reach out to these families. But meanwhile, we are also looking at previous research papers about how do parents tackle these situations. And parents have no way, they just go off to work. Mostly the grandparents will try to take care if they can, or there are maids who can maybe look after these kids. Kids mostly, if they want to take a break, they just go back to their laptops and play some virtual game. And that is the break time.
Now, when I ask how do they solve the problem, what do they do, what options do they have, where do they get frustrated, there are two angles to it. One angle is, are there any alternatives? And how do we fare, whether those alternatives are lacking in some way, and then can we be better and all that? But the main point, the major point is there some action happening right now, or have they neglected? They don't even know, they don't even realize. So what you said, did they realize or they show up, you know, they understand that this was a problem, that this skill did not develop later. That's a huge cause of concern for you to start in this area, because we need to figure out where can we come in the process of their decision making, whether I should talk to them at the time of birth, whether I should talk to them when they go for vaccine, whether I should talk to them through the pediatrician who may help diagnose if they are coming to them that, okay, is there an issue with my child, and the pediatrician refers that, okay, this might be a solution to help you with your work schedule and all that. You know, so how do they get to know, how do they learn, how will they decide whether this is for them or not? We need to understand the whole process in their life journey. You need to talk to, I understand, but this is what you need to focus on as well when you are talking to them, to really know how they will think, when they will think, where you need to prompt them, where can you show up in their face and in front of them to notice that this might be something that they need to look at. And what will they look at? How will they know? And how will they decide, you know, whether they will... Because, you know, in these things, most people think that this problem will not happen to them. Everyone else will suffer, but somehow they are God's creation, very unique creation, and this cannot happen to them. That's why people do all the stupid things that we do, right? Smoking cigarettes or binging or whatever, right? It's not healthy, but we don't think that it will affect us or as much. We can surpass all the problems and solve them. We are fit and fine. When would we notice? When would they notice about this? What will prompt them to notice? Some trigger has to be there. Maybe that trigger could come from schools, that we have been tracking the progress of your kid and this kid is not performing up to the mark in this these areas. So I don't know. You need to talk to them and understand how and when you will intervene.
So we will go to the next team, team 5.
All right. So we are group 5. It's me, Urva, Archana, Archa, Arya, and Vaishali. Our focus is basically on elementary school students belonging to the rural area or lower income groups. We had actually started this project last year and we couldn't finish it completely. So we are trying to refine it because we felt it has potential. Basically, at the time, we had researched a bit about their current state, which is like the anxiety among students in a toughest subject, which is like mathematics. That's what we thought when we interviewed and we read a few papers. Basically, there are many apps or games emerging in it, but there's a gap here that most of the students or their families, they don't have smartphones or internet connections as good as the urban population. Then most of these apps are in the English language, so they are having anxiety again, learning English or something. So that's why that's again a barrier. They have lack of information about these things. So our goal is to reduce the anxiety in mathematics, make it more fun loving, and help in learning that particular subject. Also, what we found out was maths was one of the main reasons why many children drop out also, because they find it difficult to learn because it involves practice and they find it intimidating, basically. So, there's a lot of negative emotion among students. Some of them are very good. So the ones who are very good at maths, they don't feel scared at all. But there are some who are so scared of the subject. And that has created a notion or anxiety.
Yeah, so from our research, that is the primary and the secondary research, what we found is the people in the rural, as well as people in the who are belonging to the lower income family who actually educate themselves in the government schools, they have very less accessibility to these internet available devices, for example, Android phones and computers. So we thought like how our next main concentration was how can we design something for these group of people, for the people who are from this particular sector.
Okay, so our problem statement is to design a solution for school students to make them understand the implementation of mathematics and help them use it in real life situations, because mostly the notion is that we are just studying mathematics or formulas, but we don't understand how it is used in real life. Our target is like the school students above the fourth standard, teachers and parents, so that teachers, they find it easy to teach the subject. And why is we are trying to help them understand maths? We are using games, board games most likely. And the customers are actually the schools and parents. So mostly we'll be targeting on the schools because most of the learning should happen in the school and the parents should not be burdened with teaching the children again after they come home. And I just want to add one point, like we had spoken to a few teachers back then, and the teachers were like, they have to create their own games for teaching children. So every time it's like an added thing on them, apart from the portion that they have to teach, they have to also think of creative ways of coming up with teaching students from, with different understanding levels. So If we have a ready-made solution for them, they can just teach them how to play the game and children can learn on their
own. You also have the game ready?
We have a model. Like we actually participated in Toykathon and we were shortlisted for one among the best 23 in India. So we had actually made a prototype for that.
You can show that.
This is one of the prototype, and we had the other one also, one that we submitted for the final Toykathon. We are still refining on that. Apura, do you want to go?
Yeah, sure. So I just want to give a basic idea. We were looking at old Indian board games, and we were seeing that because these are kind of getting, people are forgetting them. So we were studying these games, and then we came up with Palankuzi, and we studied about this game. And basically, this game is actually proven to teach counting better. So we thought that as we want to revive this game and also teach maths with it, so we sort of modified the game. This was our earlier game where we were trying to teach profit and loss, and each student have toys which they have to sell to each other. And through this, the tactics, like I will not explain the entire game, but through this, they can sell the toys and they can understand if they're making a profit or a loss. And with counting of the beats, it will be easier for them.
My guess is that, you know, if you're targeting schools and parents, now in case of parents,
we're not targeting on parents. We're only targeting on school and teachers here because this is for the rural.
All right. So,
yeah.
Fine. Then it is fine. And I liked the way you phrased that there are some teachers who are thinking of creative ways to help their students learn. But you need to figure out where do you find them? Who are they? If, you know, are all teachers like that, or are there some who are more and two more eager or more driven, or, you know, maybe the school management is such that they are tracking and they are encouraging such teachers more. So such schools where such teachers are there. So if you target that and if you make them your champion, you are ultimately helping them. And that's a very strong value. If they are driven and you are helping them get what they want to do, get that done in a nice manner, you are making their life easier. And it actually works, definitely. I think that's a nice way to go.
A lot of people, actually, the Toy Association, they're looking for new board games where there's value, and they give as birthday gifts because there's a huge market as birthday gifts to people. So when I'm looking at business, I'm looking at how to improve my business, how to make more of those, how to, you know, get them larger. So I think that focus also has to now come into your thinking that, you know, whom do I target? Where do I target and how can I make more?
That's a nice angle, right? So educated folks would like to gift games which also are enhancing learning. So that could be a nice segment. You know, people who care about education, so in gifting, in buying games for their own kids, that may be a good segment. On the teacher's part, try to detail it out. Where would you find, do these teachers consume specific types of material, subscribe to some, you know, Facebook pages to get more ideas, or some other Reddit groups, or attend some conferences, present somewhere? Are these schools active in some way? Can you really, you know, find some signals to spot them from the crowd? That's the main thing we are looking for, so that your discovery of them and their discovery of you, where do they search for solutions? Where do they go and try to figure out what next can I do? And how can someone or you suggest this solution to them? So how do you discover them and how do they discover you? That's the main thing that you need to figure out.
Okay, we'll go to the next team. Thanks, Sareen. Next team is Team 6.
So coming to our need identification, so we went through a lot of ideas and then we sort of realized that one of the major things that we as kids also must have experienced, or our parents at least did, like what our parents tell us, is that they had feeding difficulties when we were toddlers, like 1 to 3 years of age. And we had these signs and symptoms, and few of the ones that we could understand from the research so far that we've done is there is a sort of food refusal, and then there's prolonged mealtimeness, and then stressful mealtimes for both the kids and the parents, or even the caretakers or school teachers who have to feed in the daycare centers. And then there is distraction. And added to that distraction, for today's kids, they hand over cell phones to the kids so that the mealtime gets faster and they eat as quick as possible. And then there is lack of appropriate independent feeding, which is sort of a latent need that we realized that a lot of parents think that they can feed the kids till the age of 5 or at least 4. But the sort of thing that they don't realize is that kids are capable enough to eat from the age of 1.5. They can eat on their own, not from the spoons, but at least from the hands. So they can inculcate that bit on them. And then there is a failure of progress on advanced textures, like, you know, starting from mashed potato to broccolis. So that these were like few things that we could identify as needs. Coming to the problem statement, so we sort of zeroed down on how could we reimagine a tangible way to make an eating experience for the toddlers from the age of 1 to 3 more interactive. So it's going to be product based, but we haven't really thought of a product yet because there are too many things listed, and we to make it sort of a business model, we have to start with one need to start with. But so there is a lot of scope to expand and advance. But looking at the number of needs that the toddlers as well as the parents have, we need to zero down on one to at least show a prototype. So that's where we are currently. And the customer is obviously the caregivers, the parents and the teachers, and the users would be the toddlers of the product that we would come up with. And then just a bit of what, why, where and when and who.
I think the problem identification is spot on.
Yeah,
as you would have guessed, we have faced the problem. I have seen people facing the problem in my circle.
The basic, I think the focus is very good, but I think we have to deep dive into the parents' requirements. And of course, if it's a gadget, like a tablespoon combination, I don't know what it is, or a plate combination, you have to conceptualize your out of the box idea too. Then we'll have something to talk to, right? So we'll go to the next team.
So mainly me, Raghul, Sneha and Vinisha, we are in the team, and we are mainly focusing on VR for education and specific to like from class 5 to like a class 10th. And we are mainly focusing on cognitive and psychomotor skills because we believe that this time pe unka sabse zyada development hota hai of their brain, where they learn, they're thinking about the cognitive modes and they learn about all the different aspects. Even the psychomotor skills that are developed, they learn about speed, distance and time, all the moments, about the coordination and manipulation and everything. So what we are trying to do is like, if we can have a VR experience to them, so that it's very hard to actually remember few of the things for the cognitive sense. And if we have made a VR experience for that, they can actually easily relate that what they are doing. So we are mainly focusing on that.
Some of the problems that we identified were people learn best by doing, but however, that is not happening a lot over here. And I think the visceral reactions to the text and image content that is consumed, I don't think that's powerful enough or sensory enough to form memories and remember all the content that is being consumed. And the Indian education system from first standard to 12th has sort of turned into an assembly line model where you drop in knowledge and check if it's working and then drop in again and check. And the same pattern has been repeated for so long right now. And Bloom's taxonomy has been used for some parts, but it's not used to its full capacity throughout the school systems.
How did we come to this conclusion after we did our problem statement? We actually deep dived into trying to understand what is the scenario of the Indian education system right now with the central boards. So we did understand that with CBSE, it's more content-driven. With the international boards, it's more skill-based. And with ICSE, it's more application-based. But if we can have a platform where all of these three things could be clubbed together in terms of giving the child or the student a more cognitive and psychomotor combined learning, which will enhance the child's capabilities, is what we were aiming at.
So we thought of dividing chapters into concepts and actually focusing on the concepts rather than building a chapter-wise module for them. So we actually want the children and environment to interact in a way that they develop their cognitive and psychomotor skills without just fixating on certain chapters and just reading and memorizing and giving tests. We want them to feel that environment and enable them to visualize their surroundings and feel that surrounding. Like if you're talking about evaporation, then they will see that droplets going up and then coming down as rain. And so they will experience it that will make them remember and be a part of that environment. So we are focusing on that currently. Actually, Raghul and Vinisha have been working on this project for a while, and they have come up with a prototype and they have done a research as well on this. So maybe they can elaborate on that.
Yeah, we do have a working prototype, which is a very rough prototype at the moment that we have actually, we've been able to experience in VR glasses that we've able to build right now. It's a set of four modules that explains concept that require or that aids the use of virtual reality. So we picked virtual reality because we thought that that could be the platform where we could combine the cognitive and the psychomotor skills in one place, where people will be able to move and understand the concept at the same time, or people will be able to enhance their skills and remember and apply their cognitive skills to the maximum. So that is why we went ahead with VR. We still at the testing phase. Whatever we made right now is not being tested, but we do have a prototype in place.
Okay, all right.
So
when you say people can move, are you planning to enable them to do this at home or at school?
We haven't decided that. So that is one aspect that we're still working on in terms of...
Because then you need to think about the space, right? How much space do they need to be able to move without hitting onto things and breaking things?
Right. So we're still thinking about if it's going to be independent learning modules or if this could be something that can be adapted to schools, like how Educom was once a one classroom activity, but then now it's become something that was applied to all the classrooms. So if this is something that over the learning period or over a learning curve, this can be adapted to a setting like that.
Let us look at the business aspect very, very closely. How will you sell? What are the costs involved? So all those has to come in. So we'll go back to team 7. Karan?
So we started looking at the various day-to-day life problems that we might encounter in that particular segment. We did some brainstorming and we put together all those problems that you can see on the screen. Later, we narrowed down those problems, focusing only on backpacks, trying to think that what are the problems that might be a value addition or value proposition in this particular segment. The problem statement that we finalized was, how might we make kids' backpack engaging, interesting, playful, and fun? And the reason why, because primary school kids carry a backpack on a daily basis and they interact with it every day in the classes. Of course, the post-COVID time, this has been changed a little bit, but again, this is something that is going to stay. And the target user is going to be two categories. The first one is the user, the children's age group from 5 to 12, and the buyers are going to be their parents. And we thought of what value proposition that can be added to the segment is that making kids' backpack fun, it is going to help kids engage more with education in a passive way. And we can add a dimension of playfulness to somewhat boring backpacks that we see in the market right now. We thought of many ideas, and the one that we narrowed it down to is a gamification, like adding something that kids can interact and play with a backpack. So we were thinking that there are two kinds of entrepreneurships. One is like solving a particular problem, and another segment is a problem is not something that is there, but a value proposition is there. For example, something related to arts and aesthetics. Similar situation is happening in our particular case, because if we look at the functionality of a backpack, any kind of backpack would do the job more or less, but we are just adding a dimension of gamification to it, adding a value proposition.
The problem is not clear. I know that you want the backpacks to be engaging or in something for kids, but what is the problem? That's not clear.
That only we want to ask, is it necessary that we need to solve a problem?
Let's not use the word problem then. Let's say the need. If the need is novelty, that I want something new, something else, something other, which is exciting, which is new, which no one else has, it's unique. Could be, it's an emotional need, then that's how you need to spin it. That's how you need to understand that what is the purchase behavior of this target population, how frequently they buy. Do they buy one backpack a year or multiple backpacks a year? Or when do they buy boring backpacks? When do they buy engaging backpacks? But something you must have to solve. It could be a problem that you are solving. It could be a psychological, emotional need that I just want something new. I'm getting bored, I need to shop.
We are not looking at directly at the problem, but we are looking at the opportunity that is there in the sector.
If it is growing, if it is big enough, these kinds of ideas are difficult to get funded for early stage team. If you show growth, if you are able to show very high growth very soon, then maybe investors will get interested that, okay, there is something unique that you are doing, you are able to show. But if you somehow do not lift off, you know, then investors won't be interested because there is nothing as such unique in a way that no one else can compete or come in very soon to replace you. So your speed of execution will be your moat.
In fact, students, that, you know, today we got a very interesting point about the value proposition and the investors. See, we, you know, it is there. We know it will, we know it may, the business may be good or whatever, but you know, like we have to put all the, you know, all the jigsaw puzzle together to make it really, you know, work well. If you're a startup, you know, you're putting in your own money and then you have this hunch that it's going to work. Maybe it's true. You're not at all, contesting that. But, you know, the purpose, the gamification, what it is getting, or like, you know, Sarin was saying, a school now advertised that hum log educational backpack dete hain, na? To wo school ke liye wo kya hai, 1000 ki baat hai, par wo to kaafi paise le lete fees mein. So if you're targeting the schools to make this as an interesting way of bringing more, you know, more revenue to the school as well as more students to the school, because you're getting them intelligent gamification backpacks, which makes education better. So multiple things, multiple strategies. So, you know, like, you know, like, so please think about all that and we'll catch up again. So next team we have...
We'll just show the... You know, the Jambo discussions that we've been having. So our basic idea is uplifting the crafts and craftsmen, artisans, what they do. So we are assuming the problem they face is not proper merchandising, no proper advertisement. People don't know about it. And in today's age, nobody wants to buy, you know, wooden toys. People just want to buy, remote control toys. My brother, he was gifted a drone on his 10th birthday. So that's the generation gap, why, people don't want these kinds of toys. So how do we market them in a way that, you know, people reach it and then they go back into that part. Oh, SCB toys hote. The concept of Happy Meals at McDonald's. So they have this toy, which ideally has no function at all. People, but still kids, adults, whoever buys it, they love it because it's just so cute. And the idea of making it themselves, you know, putting that sticker over there, you know, building a toy, the same thing with Kinder Joy. So why not market it in a way that you don't have a choice? You get it, and then when you get it, you realize, oh, wow, this is so nice. Considering all this, our idea is to capitalize the market of craftsmanship and that process, helping them grow, uplifting them.
So the thing is that there are like many states in our country, and each state has a different kind of tradition and culture within them. But children today's children are more like inclined towards digital, as Sandra told. So they want video games and everything. So everyone is not getting to know what is authentic and to their own state. So we want to promote that so that children buy something and they open it and then they see the pieces and parts of this toy and then they assemble it. Like I'm from Bengal, so I have given an example of this wooden owl wala toy. So suppose the child opens it and it will have the beak separately, the wing separately. So he will also get a joy in assembling it. And obviously, they won't throw it away, right? It will be kept over there and they can collect it. It can be a collectible and it can, like, they can have a collection of all the states and
like 28 states, they can say that I have all the 28 collections. So that is our marketing point.
But that our target customers would be schools, teachers, and parents, and our target users would be children. And we are mainly focusing also on revival of the languishing crafts. So, for example, there is this craft called Ganjifa cards of Savanpari, Maharashtra area. So those cards can be used maybe in board games, and those board games can be like marketed, and this craft can be propagated through that. So we were also thinking about the languishing crafts also. And our approach would be that we would be focusing on the cost effectiveness, feasibility, and we would also be looking at the competitive analysis, whether such kind of products are there in the market or not, whether other people are doing similar kind of things as well or not, and also how we are going to manufacture it, the manufacturing techniques, because the manufacturing techniques would be different because we are doing a design intervention, and we'll also be conducting artisan interviews. So we still have to figure out, we have to finalize some of the crafts which we'll be taking forward.
Is a very generic input I give to all such startups who are doing anything in handicrafts and all. Sorting the supply chain may be hugely valuable to the artisans and all, and it will actually, you know, bring a lot of efficiency and lead to a lot of impact and all that. But your main problem is finding the customers for all these, right? If you can sort that part, India mein handicrafts ki, karigars ki, talent ki koi kami nahi hai. You will get your supply chain. Wo ho jayega. But getting the customer, figuring out who will buy, where will they buy, how will they buy, that is the most tricky part. Kids love all these remote controlled and, you know, drones and all that. Most likely because that is what they are getting exposed to. If parents would give them other types of toys, and if parents would spend time building those with them, kids love, especially the younger kids, love more when things are more activity oriented, when things are more building oriented. It's the parents who kill that creativity because they don't have time to spend with them. So your main challenge is the parents. So you really need to interview, how can you influence them? What will make their mindset change and adapt to all these things when it may happen? Maybe it will happen when they are visiting Sikkim and then they are thinking, yahan se kya leke jaun? Yeah, maybe I can get a local toy. I don't know. I'm just right now, you know, thinking out loud. But you need to interview and understand how, when they are buying, what they are buying, why. Is it really motivated by the child's preference, or that they have actually influenced the child's preference in such a way from the very get-go that this is what the child prefers now? But kids really don't care. I mean, I remember a colleague telling me that he forgot to bring something when he was on a trip to some other city. So he just took home the, you know, the mixer that you get with your coffee in the flight. And the kid loved it as a toy. Kids love playing with bartan in the kitchen, right? They don't care. You give them anything cool and crazy and interesting, they will love. So it's the parents who are your struggle.
Yes. So that's why we hope to market it in a way that they don't have a choice. So when parents go out to buy toys for their kids, they'll obviously go for the better ones, you know, the fancy, classy ones. But when it's, you know, given out like, you know, additional equipment, like how Happy Meal markets its toys, right? It's a free thing. You can't, you know, put your choice in it. I want another toy.
You have to figure that out, whether you want to devalue your product like that, or you can actually get some premium and you can actually position it with a better toy, a fancier toy. Why are you saying the other ones are fancy and this is not fancy? Maybe this is the fancier one.
That's a very big paradigm shift, no, students? Because that could be a case. Because see, for example, when these McDonald's and all does these toys, they're in large quantities, very, very low cost. But whereas when we go to our artisans and craftsmen, the cost is going to be a little higher.
Yes,
it can't be really given for free. Yes. it can be a remember you said the tourism hum log alag alag jaate, it could be a memorabilia where the kid will go and assemble a memorabilia from a local location. Lovzari, last team, please.
Hi, we are working currently, this is the team, and we are working on the problem statement, which is bridging the generational gap between parents and young adults using gamification. So we did a lot of research about what are the basic blocks that parents or children or just people from two generations have. And we are trying to explore that boundary and promoting interactions between the parents and their children so that there are certain blocks of communications like marriage or say sexuality or religion, which are certain things that we need to, or career, that parents and children or just people from two generations need to talk about, but are uncomfortable bringing up conversations like this or asking such uncomfortable questions or just bringing up topics. So this game is going to be built around such interactions and such conversations. It would be more of an initiator than a place to discuss, but it would just bring out you know, what perceptions people have, what are they thinking, and how can these gaps then be mended after realizing that you know, what the thought process of the people are. So because I think generation, we have categorized it as something that is meant by age, or that is you know, defined by a certain age group, but it is mostly about the events that those people have shared in common and have formed an opinion based on those events. So for us to know them and for them to know us, it's important for us to share and talk about such things, so that you know, it's easier in future in terms of coming to a conclusion on which everyone agrees and no one is rebelling out or no one is not liking a decision, so things like that. So basically mending generational gap through a game and initiating conversations on such topics is what we're going to focus on.
Who is the customer? You are selling a game. What exactly are you planning to do?
So the direct user would definitely be people who are wanting to have a conversation. And since we are going to target different conversation topics, whoever is in need of those conversations can buy that. But apart from that, also people generally tend to go to therapy for solving out such questions or needing an external help. So even then, if it could be done through a game, people who are giving therapy can just, you know, initiate this as a game that you play with each other and start a conversation. So it could be that. It could also be, you know, a part of maybe a school program or a college program where you're just trying to, you know, you see a student not doing that well and you are trying to help that student by initiating such conversations with their parents through like a game.
Direct users will use, but ultimately who will initiate that?
In India specifically, it is kind of established that the children like us and our parents, we have a generational gap. So probably it will be initiated by people like us who will introduce this to their parents.
We have different personas in customer segment. We want to solve one persona's problem. We take evidence from the other persona who may not even need to solve the problem because they are so proactive and they are already done. So here, for example, the challenge could be, maybe it is not there, but you need to be careful that it doesn't happen, is that you go and interview children whose family dynamic is such that if they wish, they can even have the conversation. They play games, they interact, they do things, right? So they will say, yes, we will play the game. But the ones who struggle, they don't even play games or have such interaction to even initiate that conversation. So how do you break that kind of, you know, situation? That's we need to be careful about. The therapy angle is feasible. But then we need to worry and we need to interview the therapists to understand if there are any, you know, ratings or certifications or, you know, something official that needs to be there before they are able to recommend, because ultimately it should not question their license and, you know, their profession. So they need to comply with some regulations, etc. So figure out where it will be the easiest to start, where the adoption will be quickest and, you know,
and larger. See, if you look at business, if you look at business, I want large number of customers and large adoption so that I can make money for my company to do rest of the personas, you know.
Yeah.
So your focus has to be there. So you all are very, very, you know, the topics are damn good, but the depth and width are too wide. So we basically focus, like what Lavsarin is saying, like it could be just that children to parents. And you know how your monetization will happen? The parents are so happy that they start giving tips to the software company which has developed this, you know? You build money while you're playing this. You don't build money upfront.
Right.
As an example, sir, we can start with a young parent. For example, their kid is in 8th standard or something. So the icebreaker for the conversation can be career. So they can start with the career aspect of it. And as the kid grow up, the parent can buy the expansion pack of or marriage or any other things, like the financial status and all that. So as the kid grows up, as the parent and kid's relationship wants, we can
कनेक्शन कर दिया ना यार, कंटिन्यूस फोन नहीं करता ना, बात नहीं करता है, तो गेम के जरिए कनेक्शन कर दिया, मैं खुश ना, सो यू गेट लॉट ऑफ मनी, सो फिर बाद में तू डेवलप कर यार, उसके बाद यू गिव मी एडिशनल थिंग्स. Start small, have a very focused customer base, very focused user, very focused financial plan ki kaise hum khareedenge. If I was a parent and, you know, you're making me talk to my teenage son who is in the US studying.
So you have one customer who is ready here.
So main to upfront paise nahi dunga, main game khelte khelte paise dunga yaar, for example. So yaar, wo ek game bana lo abhi ke liye, fir, like, then we'll see other things. Na, we'll have multiple personas, then you capture the whole segments, all the segments. But one segment you started with, you know, these two people, the, you know, like you
so just start with their persona parents. Is parents and children living in different cities.
Yeah.
It could be a WhatsApp plugin game, yaar.
Yeah.
Kisne socha nahi tha, WhatsApp plugin. Large number of users at one go, yaar. Tum to, you will become something like Bharat Pay. Thanks, Lavsarin, for that.
Thank you.
Saying, and
thank
it was
you.
Wonderful.
Same here.